Today, because it's the first day of retreat, your mind is real active, just like it normally is. That's only natural. But you're starting to teach your mind how to let go of these thoughts and relax and come back to your object of meditation. As your mind starts to get the idea of how this happens, it becomes easier and easier, especially when we don't take things so personally and get so involved in concepts and ideas, get involved in our thinking about. As we start letting go of that more and more, the suffering becomes less and less. Every time you let go of that pain, or every time you let go of that tightness in your mind and in your body, you are experiencing the cessation of perception, or you're experiencing the cessation of craving. And how do you do that? Laugh. A whole eightfold path is involved in the laugh. But you have to let go of the indulging in. That's the trick. That's the deep holding on that you have to be able to see and say, it doesn't matter whether it's there or not. It really doesn't.
Is craving the prime culprit, or is that
craving is the culprit?
Oh, okay.
The whole of the Eightfold Path, the whole of all of the Four Noble Truths, about craving and letting go of craving. Craving is the biggie. You can't stop feeling from arising. Feeling is going to be there whether you like it or not. I mean, you stub your toe, there's going to be painful feeling. And feeling arises because the conditions are right for it to arise. But right after the feeling, then craving arises. And that's that tension and tightness. And that's the start of the identification with that feeling. I like it, I don't like it. Right after that brief instant where everything tightens up, then you start having all kinds of thoughts and concepts and ideas about why you like it and why you don't like it, and that goes into your habitual tendency. So, the way you learn how to let go of your old habit of reacting in the same way you always act when you stub your toe is by watching that process and then letting go of the craving. And instead of indulging in the dissatisfaction of that painful feeling, you start pulling up a pleasant feeling of love and putting into that painful feeling, and that balances things out.
You catch it before you say, oh damn, that hurts, or you say that.
Well, sometimes you do, sometimes you don't.
It depends on
you know, there's the pain, and there's recognition of the pain, and then there's dislike of the pain, and they happen real fast. And sometimes you get caught for a little while with, that hurts and I don't like it. And then you catch yourself at that and you just kind of laugh with it. And once you start laughing, that changes your perspective. And then you can put love into that pain. And that balances everything. And there's a physiological thing that happens with that too. The pineal gland is, the brain is like two sections. And there's a membrane that goes right down the middle of it. Right in the middle of the brain, there's what's called the pineal gland. this produces all of the endorphins for your body. Endorphins is a painkiller. It's 10 times stronger than morphine. Now, when there's anger, that stops the endorphins from coming because all of the little blood vessels, all of the little muscles around there, they tense up. They don't let those endorphins release into the body, so the pain actually intensifies, gets bigger. When you start sending love into that, everything starts relaxing and the endorphins just start flooding your body, and before long you forget that you did it.
Well, people can get so quick that they can stub their toe and immediately respond.
You respond with loving kindness.
By laughing first and then...
Well, if you need to.
You can make that like a reflex response.
Mm-hmm. I was a carpenter. Mm-hmm. I hit my fingers all the time. Would pinch myself, do all kinds of crazy things would happen. And it was like there's shock. Ow, that hurt. And then I send some love into it and just go back to doing what I was doing. And then 2 or 3 hours later, I see this great big purple thing underneath my nail. You know, where'd that come from? It doesn't even hurt anymore. It's not even tender. So you're practicing the observation of the Four Noble Truths. You see when they're suffering. You see the cause of suffering. You let go of the cause, that's the cessation of the suffering. And the way to do that is to laugh. And keep your mind on a wholesome object. Loving kindness into that pain. And it doesn't necessarily even have to happen with something as big as stubbing your toe. Any kind of physical pain. I mean, you wake up in the morning and you're stiff. Start sending loving kindness into that stiffness instead of your dislike. And before long, you don't feel it. Real easy to pop up. You don't know about this, you kids.
And this works the same way with mental or emotional pain? It's
yes.
The same process?
Exactly the same. And the thing with the Buddha that's so amazing is that this is simple. He came up with the simplest, most direct method for the cessation of suffering. Having a happy mind. How do you have a happy mind? Well, smile and laugh. Changes your perspective. Every time you see yourself getting serious, smile and laugh. I used to have a tape of, it must have been 5 people that got together and they had belly laugh. And they put it on the tape for 15 minutes. That's all it was laughing. Boy, you talk about changing your mood. All you had to do is listen to that, and before long you were laughing right along with them. I lost the tape, darn it.
We'll have to make another one.
I like his attitude. Great stuff. Okay.